السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إن أصدق حديث كتاب الله عز وجل وأحسن حديث محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر أمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة دلالة وكل دلالة في النار. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. ونصلي ونسلم على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحابه أجمعين. وبعد. Last week, my dear brothers in Islam, we spoke about the blessings of being guided to this Islam and Iman. And we also mentioned being of those who have received the greatest ni'mah, the greatest blessings that anyone can have achieved in this life, which is being guided to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal that Rabbana aj'alna min al-ahli sunnah haqqan, that Allah Azza wa Jal, He make us of the people of the sunnah in truth, in reality. Allahumma ameen. And also we mentioned that there is a great obligation on those of us who claim, who make the claim that they are the people who are following or who are sticking to the Quran authentic sunnah, which is that the obligation that is upon those people is that they have to always guide themselves, their families, and the community according to the Quran authentic sunnah and understanding of the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum ajma'in. And we should never use the sunnah, we should never use the sunnah to set up slogans or political parties, or to use this as a way to call to our jama'ah or blind following or what they call hizbiya or nationalism, or to base our Islam on secrecy or hidden agendas, which we elaborated on in detail last week. So today, inshallah, bidhnillah ta'ala, will be a continuation of where we left off last week, inshallah. And I hope and I pray, bidhnillah, that it will be something of benefit for us all. Allahumma ameen. Because, my dear brothers in Islam, when we understand the tremendousness of the ni'mah and the blessing of being guided to the sunnah, which can only come about when we practice the sunnah. Because it's not the same that we are considering ourselves as Sunni Muslims, because within the people who call themselves or affiliate themselves as being the Sunni Muslims, we have a lot of ikhtilaf, a lot of differences of opinion. As we mentioned last week, the part of the hadith where the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Man ma'aish minkum," those of us who live a long time, "fasatara ikhtilafin kathiran," then we will see a lot of differences of opinion. "Fa alaykum bi sunnati," said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "I give you glad tidings to my sunnah and the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashidin al-Mahdi'in min ba'di. And I give you glad tidings of the sunnah, the legal way of implementing the Quran and sunnah of his rightly guided Khulafa after him." He said, "Addu alayhi bi nawajih," he said, "bite on to their way with your molar teeth." This is what he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when we hear this, then we should try our best to be of those who not only claim to be the people of the sunnah, but to be in actuality those people who are following the Quran and sunnah haqqan. So we ask Allah, we should always be of those who ask Allah to make us sincere in our claim. When we claim to be of those who are the people of the sunnah, we should ask Allah to make us of ahl sunnah haqqan, in truth and in reality, without any kind of political slogans or hidden agendas or any kind of hizbiyah or secrecy within our call. And we also mentioned the tremendous statement of the Imam of Dar al-Hijrah, Imam Malik, where he said, "As-sunnah kasafinatu nuh, man raqib faqad najah." He said, rahimallah, that the sunnah is like the ark of Noah. The sunnah is like the ship, the boat of Noah. Whoever embarks on the sunnah, then they will be saved. And whoever refuses to get on the sunnah by saying this is only sunnah. This is not fard. This is not a must. This is only sunnah. Whatever they want to say. This is against my madhab, or this is against my a wave of my jama'ah, or whatever they say, whatever they claim as an excuse or for as a reason to say that they don't want to get on the sunnah. If we ever, and I hope that we would take time to ponder on this tremendous statement of the great Imam, Imam Malik, when he said that the sunnah is very simple. And when we hear this, we should understand that he is saying this is also in connection with the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, where he said, خَيْرَ خَلَامْ مَا قَلْ وَدَلْ, that the best speech is that which is short and straight to the point. So if we understand the tremendousness of the statement of this great Imam, where he said that the Sunnah is like the Ark of Noah, this is the blueprint of our life. And when we understand this, that we could be living a life, and most of us, we don't understand how we're supposed to live until we embark on the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's the way to live. That's the blueprint of our life. So if we stick to this blueprint of life, then inshallah, we will najah. We will be of those who are of the Farqat Najiyah, as we mentioned last week, the Taifat al-Mansura, and all of those other names that the people attach to themselves with the claim that they're following the Sunnah. So if we make that claim, then we better back up our claim with practical application. Because none of us are perfect, and we should try our best. Because there's going to be a time, as we mentioned last week, لَا يَنْفَ مَا وَلَا بْنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهُ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. That will be a time when there will be no benefit of our wealth or our children or our social status or whatever we have amassed in this life, except for the person who stands in front of Allah with a clear heart, a clear conscience, a clear mindset. And we have to understand that if we have to, when we stand in front of Allah, if in this life we're not able to explain our position, why we say this or why we do that, or why we're following this ahadith or this understanding over the authentic statements of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then we're going to definitely have a hard time explaining that in front of Rabbul Alameen. There's a hadith which has been recorded in the Sahih of Imam Muslim and Nasa'i on the authority of Ibn Abi Hatim, that Anas ibn Malik, who said that one day, he said, Anas ibn Malik, we were sitting with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and they seen him smile. They seen him smile so broadly that his back teeth were visible. They could see his back teeth. And then he, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, said, do you know why I am smiling? The people, they said, Allah wa Rasuluhu Alam. He, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, said that I am looking, and there will be a time on the day of judgment when the believer, رَبْنَا جَعَلَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ حَقٍ أَلْهُمَّ عَمِينَ. O Allah, may Allah make us of the true believers. أَلْهُمَّ عَمِينَ. There will be a day, he said, the believer will be called to account on the day of resurrection, and his Lord will show him his deeds. Just between him and his Lord. He said that Allah Azza wa Jal will take that believer privately, quietly, and he will show him, that believer, his deeds. Just between him and his Lord. And he will say, Allah will say to that believer, did you not do such and such and such and such a day when you didn't think anybody seen? Did you not do such and such and such and such a thing? And the believer will admit it and say, yes, I did that. Allah will say, I forgive you. I forgive you of those sins, and I conceal them from the people. And no creature on the earth would have seen them, and no creature in the heavens will see them. And then Allah Azza wa Jal will show him his good deeds, and his deeds will be visible. And he will be so excited and happy, and he'll want to show his good deeds to the people. And then we will want all of the people to see them. Then the disbeliever, the Prophet ﷺ, he goes on and says, then the disbeliever and the munafiqin, the kuffar and the hypocrites, will be brought to account, and his Lord will show him their deeds, and they will deny them by saying, Ya Rabb, bi'izzatik, by your might and by your glory, O my Lord, We did not do these things. The angels, they had written down these things incorrectly. They wrote down things which I did not do. The angel will say to him, did you not do such and such a thing on such and such a day and in such and such a place? He will say, La, Ya Rab, Be'izzatik. No, O my Lord, by your glory, I did not do those things. When he says that, Allah Azza wa Jal will seal their mouths. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he said, I think that the first part of the body of the disbelievers and the munafiqeen that will be able to speak will be the right thigh, the right thigh. And then he recited, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the verse in Surah Yasin, ayah number 67, where it says, Al-yawma nakhtumu ala afwa'ihim wa tukallimuna aydihim wa tashhadu arjulihim bima kanu yaksibun. This day we shall seal up their mouths and their hands will be made to speak to us and their legs will bear witness to what they used to earn. With this in mind, my dear brothers in Islam, we all have an equal responsibility in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. We all have a chance, my dear brothers in Islam, in this life. We all have a chance and we all have equal responsibility with the taqwa of Allah Azza wa Jal. And we have to try and manifest this taqwa literally in our lives. That's what Allah Azza wa Jal says in the surah called the manifestation of law, Surah Taghban, where he says, يَوْمَ يَجْمَعُكُمْ لِيَوْمًا جَمْعًا ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ تَغَابٌ. There will be a day, Allah Azza wa Jal says, the day when he will gather you all on the day of gathering. That will be the day of the Taghban, which the Mufassirin said that the meaning of this is the manifestation of loss. Those people in this life, meaning the hypocrites and the munafiqeen, who had believed that they had amassed and they acquired so much in this life of wealth, position, authority, whatever it may have been. On that day of loss, manifestation of loss, they will see. Meaning that this is the day when the earlier and the latter generations will stand and bear witness. And we'll all be gathered in one place, in one arena, where all of us will be able to see the earlier and the latter generations. We'll all be gathered in one arena where we'll all be able to hear the words and be able to see each other clearly. And we'll be able to see ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ تَغَابٌ. And Ibn Abbas, Hamallah, radiallahu anhu, said that it is one of the names of the Day of Judgment. And that is because the people of Jannah will have gain over the people of the hellfire. رَبْنَا جَعَلَ مِنْ أَهْلِ جَنَّةِ اللَّهُمَّ آمِينَ. There's no mutual loss or gain greater than on that day, the Day of Taghabun, when everything will be made plain and manifest for us all to see. So today, my dear brothers in Islam, part of the blessings of being guided to being considered as the people of the Sunnah, we have a chance right now to try our best to be of those people in truth and reality. Whenever we hear the statements of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the authentic statement of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we should say, سَمِعْنَا وَعَطَانَا. We hear and we obey. If we're weak, we shouldn't deny the truth by saying that that is only sunnah, or we don't have to do that. It is not in the Quran. Show me in the Quran. And the Salaf used to say, part of the ni'mah or the blessings on the youth, on the shabab, is that they are guided to one of the elders of the sunnah. But this is a blessing. If we understand this ni'mah that Allah Azza wa Jalla has blessed some of us with, being guided to the sunnah, and right now, we're maybe not able to enumerate that great blessing. But there will be a time when we all have to stand in front of Allah. And those hypocrites and those munafiqeen, that's lil afia, they will not have anything to deny. We will have nothing to deny, but our deeds will be made transparent. So we have to ask Allah Azza wa Jal from His names and His attributes that He blesses us and He keeps us attached to the Quran and authentic Sunnah. It's a very sad reality, my dear brothers in Islam, that a lot of us, as Muslims, we are unaware of the fact that the Rasul ﷺ spent the majority of his time in his da'wah, in the Quran, explaining and extolling the ayat in the Quran, and explaining it by his example, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we do not understand that the Quran is packed with lessons and ayat explaining the importance of tawheed. When we say that we follow Allah Azza wa Jal, that we're a Muslim and we believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, we can never ever be real, true believers in haq, in reality, until we implement the ittiba' al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have to have mercy on ourselves, and we have to understand that if we leave off the understanding, the correct understanding of tawheed in all of its aspects, and we can never understand the tawheed in reality until we do it to ittiba' Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the only way. There's no other way. We cannot say that we learn our deen through a certain peer or through a certain jama'ah or a certain furqah, because it's only one correct understanding of Islam, which is coming from the Quran, authentic sunnah, and understanding, which is founded upon the understanding of the salaf of this ummah. So my dear brothers in Islam, while we are living today, subhanallah, while we're alive and well today, we're eating, we're drinking, we're going to work, we're playing sports, we're doing all these things, but the problem is a lot of us lack the correct understanding of Islam. And the correct understanding, as Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said, the Islam is a sunnah and the sunnah is Islam. You can never have one without the other. If you have Islam and it's not in accordance with the Quran and the sunnah, then we are lost, because we cannot have one without the other. As the Rasul ﷺ said in authentic hadith, which has been found in the sunnah of Imam Abu Dawood, that أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ فَمِثْلُهُ مَعْ, that I, he said, ﷺ, have been given the Quran and something similar to it, which is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So we understand the Quran only through the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And how do we understand the sunnah? Not according to our understanding, not according to their understanding, but how Ashab Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood the Quran and the sunnah. As Allah Azza wa Jalla says, in aminu bimithi amantum bihi faqad ihtadaw. If we believe like they believe, then we will have been guided to the correct and proper guidance. So our understanding of the Quran is not according to our understanding or the understanding of this sheikh or this jama'ah. No, we cannot just open a hadith and say this is the hadith. But how did the Sahaba understand it? We cannot all know asbab al-nuzul, why these ayats were revealed, or why Rasul ﷺ said this or that. So as I said before, that part of the ni'mah, the blessing of the youth, is that they have been guided to a man or an elder of the sunnah. So we have to ask Allah Azza wa Jal that He Azza wa Jal, He guides us and He shows us the correct path. Because Allah Azza wa Jal says, He reminds us in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayat number 208 to 209. And we have to always remember, and we have to always remind ourselves constantly, that Allah Azza wa Jal guided us to Islam, and it's upon us to appreciate that guidance, that whenever we hear the correct guidance, we say we hear and we obey. Sami'na wa atana. Not like the Yahud who say Sami'na wa asaina. We hear and we disobey. We have an opportunity right now. Allah Azza wa Jal, He reminds us in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayat number 208 to 209. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, adkhulu fi silmi kaffa, wa la tattabi'u khudwat ash-shaytan, innahu lakum aduwwun mubin. O you who believe, enter into the silm of Islam perfectly, to the best of our ability, and let us not follow the footsteps of the shaytan, because he is to us a clear, open, apparent enemy. And this silm is Islam. At-tabi'u, faqad qafitum. This Imam Auza'i said that we have just been ordered to follow because we've been given sufficiency. So we do not have to innovate any new practices into Islam. All we have been given has been given sufficiency. What we have is sufficiency. So all of it is upon us is that we hear and we obey. May Allah Azza wa Jalla bless us and give us a tawfiq that whenever we hear the truth, we follow it. أقول قول هذا شكرا وأتوب إليه. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وبهدى وبعد. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, "Attaqallaha ma istata'at," that we have to have the consciousness, the reverence, the fear of Allah to the best of our ability. It's very difficult to translate this word attaqwa, but all of us have a responsibility to have the consciousness of Allah. But we have a problem in our ummah that a lot of us may have asked an imam or a scholar, and we say that this is what that sheikh said, and whatever it is, it's on him. Whether he's right or wrong, it's on him. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Qadi fi Jannah wa Qadi'an fi Nar. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there's a judge who is in Jannah, in paradise, and there are two judges who are in the hellfire. The judge who, when you go to him and you ask him for the guidance, you ask him a question, and they give you the correct answer, not according to his whims or desires, then he is in paradise. And there's a judge who judges according to his tribe, his khabir. He judges according to his understanding of back home. He's in hellfire. Or a person, he judges according to his own whims and desires. The qadi, he knows the truth, but he judges according to the person. He judges according to his own understanding. He doesn't judge according to the Quran, authentic sunnah. And the judge who judges according to nothing, he is jahil. He does not have the correct understanding of the Quran and sunnah. He does not know how to apply the fiqh. Then he is in hellfire. The Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives us many examples of how to seek the correct guidance. But we have to know, my dear brothers in Islam, we all have a responsibility to have the taqwa of Allah. We cannot pass the buck and say that it's on them. He gave us the fatwa. It's his fault. We have an intelligence. We all have a state or level of understanding. We have this. Allah gave each and every one of us a level of understanding. So we cannot blame somebody else for our wrong understanding. So my dear brothers in Islam, the basic thing that we have to understand, as we mentioned before, and we always mention, that we have to understand what is Tawheed. And we have to understand what is the opposite of Tawheed, which is a shirk. And only thing we can understand is that Allah Azza wa Jalla, he brought us into existence, la ya'lamuna shay'an. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he brought each and every one of us into existence, and we have not known anything. We came out of the bellies of our mothers ignorant. We did not know anything. And now we learn a few things. But I want to mention just one aspect, which is a shirk. And to go into that, we need to know by example that a lot of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam today, and there's millions of Muslims today who are involved in shirk. We are calling ourselves the people of the Sunnah. We are calling ourselves the people of the Sunnah, or other people call us the people of the Sunnah. But a lot of us are involved in shirkiyats, and there's a lot of different aspects of shirk. So, if you ask a Muslim who said that they believe in Allah, and the majority of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they only understand Allah by the understanding of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, that Allah is a Raziq, he gave us food, he gave us clothing, he gave us drink, he gave us warm place to sleep. But there's a lot more to understanding of Tawheed than just that. A lot of us, we say we believe in Allah, but we're associating partners with Allah Azza wa Jalla. It is not enough for us to just say that we believe in Allah and not understand that there's aqsam of tawheed and there's different darajat of shirk. For example, there is a shirk in our dua that people, they're making dua to other than Allah. Millions of Muslims, they're going to the graves of the so-called awliya, those walis of Allah, those people who were maybe at one time close to Allah, or the saints at the graves, istighatha. Some people are slaughtering another. They're making oaths to other than Allah. They're saying that I swear by such and such or fulan and fulan. And there are millions of Muslims on a regular basis who are making oaths to other than Allah. There are many Muslims who are swearing by the name of their mother. I swear on my mother. They said, I swear on my father's. Or they even said, I swear on the Kaaba. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من يحذر فيحذر لله. Whoever makes an oath, then let them make an oath by the name of Allah. And also, الرياء, showing off. This is a common thing, and this is a very hidden type of shirk that we are showing off in our good deeds. You will not find anybody who like to show off in doing their bad deeds. They like to do their bad deeds in privacy. And none of us are free of sin. We all make sins, as the Rasul ﷺ said, كُلُّ بَنِيَانْ خَطَّعُونَ وَخَيْرَ خَطَّعِينَ التَّوَّابِينَ. All of the sons and daughters of Adam, we make mistakes. And the best of those who have made mistakes are those who turn to Allah Azza wa Jal in repentance. But there are Muslims who like to show off in our good deeds, riya, which refers to, which the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that, is with the intent of doing a deed so other people can see what we're doing. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, beware, iyak, he said, of the hidden type of shirk. And he said it is more concealed than a black ant is in the middle of the night. And that is the riya, showing off of our good deeds. And also, my dear brothers in Islam, when we speak, we have to speak the truth and the reality that there are millions of Muslims in the world who are involved in a shirkiyat. This is associating partners with Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he says very clearly in the Quran, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he's mentioned this in the Sunnah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرْ أَنْ يَشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرْ مَا دُنَا ذَلِكْ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. He said, Azza wa Jal, that verily Allah Azza wa Jal will not forgive that partners are set up with him, but he will forgive anything that is less than that to whomsoever he wills. There's many Muslims who are doing a thing called going to a sheikh or a mulana, or usually there are people who claim, or they may look like they are religious, but they are magicians and they are writing things on amulets, or they call them ta'weez, or in Arabic they call it hijab. This is what many Muslims are doing. Many of Muslims are doing this all over the world. They're going to somebody and they're writing usually some words in Arabic, or they might mix some words from the Quran and some other numbers and symbols, which is numerology, and all of these things of devilish inspiration and hocus pocus and some kind of mumbo jumbo that they write, and then they tie it and they fold it on a small piece of paper, and then they usually tie it up with black thread and a little black pouch or a locket, which is connected to a black thread or leather thing, and they hang it around their neck or they put it on their arm. And in Arabic, they call it hijab, or in the Indian subcontinent, they call it ta'weez or a locket. Or these things are all shirkiyat. There are many, many hadith on this subject, but I'll just name a few to end off. There's a hadith on the authority of Imran bin Hussein, who said that the Prophet ﷺ saw a man wearing a brass ring on his arm. And he said, Ma hadhi? The Rasul ﷺ asked him, what is this? He said, the man said to the Prophet ﷺ, this is because of wahan. I have some weakness, wahan, weakness in my limbs or arthritis. And you see this in a health food store. They have a brass ring that they have on the finger, or a brass thing that they have on their wrist. They said, the Rasul ﷺ said to him, Ma yazidak illa wahan. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, remove it, for innaha la yazid illa wahn. He said, remove it, because it will not increase you except in weakness and sickness. And then he said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, if you were to die and that brass thing was on your arm, then you would have never ever attained success. As I said, there's many, many ahadith, but I'll mention one more on the authority of Uqba bin Amr Al-Juhini, that a group came to the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to give the bay'ah, to make the pledge of allegiance to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that they believe in Allah and him as his messenger. And nine of them came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to give the pledge of allegiance. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took the bay'ah from eight of them, but he refused to take from one of them. He shook the hands of all eight and he withdrew his hand from the nine. The man, they said that he's one of us. He came with us. Why are you shaking his hand? The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because he's wearing a tamima. He's wearing a ta'weez. He's wearing a hijab. So the man put his hand inside of his sleeve or his shirt and he removed that ta'weez. And then the Rasul ﷺ took his bear. Then the Rasul ﷺ, he said, "Man ta'allaq bitamimatin faqad ashrak." He said, ﷺ, whoever wears a ta'weez, an amulet, or what they call in Arabic a hijab, then they have committed shirk. So my dear brothers in Islam, from what we have mentioned today, we have to understand that Allah can overlook and He can forgive any sin except shirk. And we all, I'm sure, that we all know of somebody in our community who is wearing some sort of a ta'weez or a talisman or amulet. We all know that. We all have seen that. So let us, inshallah, be vigilant and try and help our brothers and sisters in Islam. Because these are things which are shirk. These things are shirk. So we all have a responsibility. We all have a duty upon ourselves and upon our families and our communities to remove this shirk from within ourselves. Because Allah Azza wa Jal is wahid. He's al-ahad. He is one and He's alone. So if we are sincere in our worship towards Allah Azza wa Jal, then He will help us. Let us remove these things from ourselves and our neighbors and our community. And let us put our trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. And know that Allah Azza wa Jal, He will help us in any way. We don't need to put on any kind of ta'weez or any hijab. Man tawakkala ala Allah fa huwa hasbu. In Allah qad baligh al-amri. Allah Azza wa Jal says, whoever puts their trust in Allah, then He'll be sufficient for us. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He has made everything clear. Everything has been written. We mentioned that many times before. So we have to, inshallah, be Ahl Sunnah haqqan. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us of the people of the Sunnah in truth, in reality. And may Allah Azza wa Jal cause us to live and die on the Sunnah with true trust and reliance on Him. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya alladhina amanu, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tasliman. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barak ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka hamidun majid. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار واقم الصلاة